those of you who are guests or have prayer requests, but do keep in mind you're still out of that perforated paper, and so tear it very gently, otherwise you might tear more than just the connection card. So stuff that's happening here at Lake Christian Church, we are gearing up for Back Church Sunday, and so to help advertise that and spread the word through the community, we have our invitation cards out by the Welcome Center. So grab 2, grab 10. I'm not sure if we have enough for everyone to have 10, but make sure to grab some invitation cards to help spread the word about Back to Church Sunday. In regards to the youth group, we have youth group tonight from 5:30 to 7:30. And Tuesday will be our last official summer youth hour day, and it's going to be awesome. We're going to have a pizza party and board game card game day. So if you would like to go, please let me know so I know how much pizza to get. Are there any other announcements this morning?
Golden Years is Tuesday. We are going to Shannon's in Bloomington. And anyone who would like to ride, I think we'll meet at the south end of the Tractor Supply parking lot. And you can either catch a ride with somebody or a follow up.
So Golden Years on Tuesday, if you need a ride, you need
to have we'll meet up there at 11 o'clock.
At 11 o'clock, perfect. Any other announcements? All right, Gracie, you're up.
To us when we did not deserve anything but death and separation from you. You knew that we could not remove our sin on our own, and there is no work that we can do to make ourselves good enough to be in the presence of God in heaven. We are grateful beyond measure that through the blood of Jesus we can not only have him in our presence, but living in us through your Holy Spirit. What a blessing we have received to be able to be called your children. And we humbly worship you today as our Father and our God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Grace in us we pray, unveil our bed. others from the fire and save them. To others show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh.
Thank you. our sins could be forgiven and we could be in the presence of God. When it comes time to remembering the sacrifice Christ made for us, we have many ways to bring it to our minds and help us remember his sacrifice. The very act of taking communion together helps us remember together. The Bible, God's Word, helps us remember. The Bible is always a place to read and study, and it never changes, although it can tell the story from more than one point of view. We read an account of the Last Supper in all four Gospels, and communion is talked about in other New Testament books. Prayer also helps us remember and lets us talk directly to God, helping us draw near to him and understand his ways better. Jesus instructed his disciples about communion at the Last Supper, and he gives us the same instructions today. Do this in remembrance of me. As we take the bread and drink from the cup, pray that we always keep the memory of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection alive in our hearts. Let us pray. Father God, creator of all that we understand and all that we do not understand, thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus, who died on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. Please help us to remember his sacrifice now and throughout the coming week, and help us to live our lives as you would have us live them. Also, please help us to grow and strengthen our relationship with you. In Jesus' name.
Okay, good night. See you in a while. Okay, as we come to our time of praise and prayer this morning, do we have any praises to bring to the Lord today? Cindy's sister Kathy, came through her surgery well, and gonna go to nursing home for a little bounce back, and should be doing great. So, anything else this morning?
My friend Patty is gaining strength back. In fact, I was able to meet her in Mount Pulaski for lunch this week.
Okay.
Prayers are working. Keep them going.
All right. Keep your prayers going for Judy's friend Patty, who was she actually got to have lunch with us last year.
Doherty.
Yeah, doesn't spell like it sounds. Doherty, she took a fall and subsequently they discovered she had a brain bleed and she is not in the hospital. Please confirm your prayers. Charlie Wilson, be with him this week. It's Tuesday. He goes into trying to get his eye surgery redone again. And then wife told me John Torbert is a niece of her husband. Been in the hospital with some medical issues, so please keep him in your prayers. Last week we added, over the course of the week, Penny Wheeler had some hand surgery. Everything okay?
Did great, thanks.
Okay. And Jan Rutledge, in the hospital with COVID on a ventilator, and did not get any updates this week, so keep her in your prayers. And I think that was all the updates I had. Also, keep obviously Jim and Kim aren't here today, so keep them in your prayers as I get through a battle with COVID. Anything else this morning? Updates or any prayer requests?
I have a praise and a prayer request. Mom's been doing really well, well enough that she can have the procedure that she's needed to have for quite some time. She's having that on Wednesday.
All right. And remind me of your mom's first name again.
Martha.
Huh?
Martha.
Martha.
Okay.
Thank you. So Martha's getting better, which is a good thing, but it also means now she's well enough to have the certain procedure that she needed to have for a while. So be with Martha this week as she has a procedure. I'm Gina.
So Brian Neisinger is listed in the bulletin, and actually there's a correction to that. He is still on life support. I don't know any other details.
Yeah, that was the last details. Renee sent that out late last night or this morning. So yeah, continue to keep Brian and Neisinger, Harold Sun, in your prayers. He's still battling COVID and is currently still on life support. So.
And also, keep Sarah. Bye-bye, Sarah.
Bye-bye, Sarah. Back to school.
She goes back to school on Thursday.
All right. To be with Sarah, she's going back to school. We'll see you around the holidays, I suppose. All right. Anything else this morning?
There were some updates on Jan this week. Jan.
Did they get out to vacation?
Oh, that's Jan Turnbull. They're off. They're in Florida.
All right.
I don't know anything else.
Yeah, if you're on the email chain, you saw Jan's every other day updates on how she was doing and waiting to get out of here. Her and Mike are on vacation now, so that's good.
Well, this was Jan Rutledge. There was some updates on her. They are getting ready to do a test on her to see if they can take the bit out. So she's been progressing, and they're getting ready for that.
All right.
One big test.
One big test. Oh, and then I forgot my phone. Jim's off the grab. Jim also texted me, but I hate that. Jim, don't do that. He sent me a text update. Connor Husted, and his family have been to church with us before, is in the last stages of his boot camp. 12-hour test coming up. Once he's done with that, he's done with boot camp, so he'll be moving on. Anything else? Mom this week is hopefully by Tuesday she's ready to start her treatments. Right. Anything else? If I can look around right at the same time, that's a trick. Alright, let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all that you do for us each and every day. We thank you for showing us the signs of your work in our world with all the reasons you give us to bring you praise. We pray that you would be with all those that we've mentioned this morning to keep them to do doing better and providing guidance for doctors and nurses and those providing care to take care of those that are in need of your help. We love you and thank you for all these things.
So my wife and I recently started a new TV show. We started watching This Is Us. So for those of you who have seen it, you know how good it is. We've been watching it for about a week and a half, and we are already on season 4 because we tend to binge. Something that we like to do a lot of times in the evening is watch TV. And what's often frustrating for Bethany is that, you know, for the first few episodes, maybe the first season, I'm completely quiet. I'm watching, I'm intent. But little by little, I start talking, and I will give out my predictions for what I think is going to happen. And what's frustrating for Bethany is oftentimes I'm right. Because I am obsessed with stories, with film culture, and I love seeing how each show, each movie has tendencies to overlap. There are certain patterns that you can see in every single film or movie. And it's fun for me, but frustrating for her. But there are certain cultural tropes or certain patterns in film that we all know. For example, red shirts in Star Trek. So if you've seen Star Trek, or if you haven't seen Star Trek, whenever there is somebody new that shows up with a red shirt in Star Trek, you know by the end of the episode that dude's getting capped, like he's dead. And I noticed this carries over to like any other show. Like if you're watching a military movie and they're starting to give the background to like some insignificant character, I'm like, he's gonna die, not gonna be dead. Or you have this like the scary film. You have like the person taking a shower, just coincidentally. Oh, that person's gonna die. Or the person is just like, oh no, I just saw like two people get dead. I'm gonna go explore the same area. Like, no. Or, especially around the holidays, every Hallmark movie ever. And then a couple more. The I Am Your Father trope. That there's this secret villain that the hero discovers. Oh, no, this person is related to me somehow. And then he has to convert him back over to the good side. Or, of course, probably the most overused one in the last decade, the fulfill a prophecy type. The Harry Potter, the Luke Skywalker, the Frodo Baggins, that they have some sort of adventure quest to go on to fulfill a prophecy. And oftentimes when we're little, we tend to think that's how the world is, that the world tends to be that predictable and we treat it that way. And it's very easy to take that mindset and assume that it applies elsewhere, especially when it comes to Scripture. So when we take our culture and we use our 21st century applications within a first century document, we can oftentimes see tropes and ideas and patterns of Scripture that aren't really there. So it's similar to how if you tell a child that there are monsters everywhere, or if there are monsters in the dark, they will see monsters everywhere, it's dark. So in the same way, if we hold these patterns and commonalities, and we treat them as reality, then we assume people outside our culture did and behaved as such, which leads us to things like this. This week I was on Twitter, and I saw a lot of really weird tweets from people who are ministers. One of them was a minister that claimed that the Great Commission passage that Jesus gave was sexist. And I'm like, what? I saw another minister say that the Bible is oppressive because it mentions slavery. And now the Bible does mention slavery. The Bible even, you know, exemplifies the logistics of buying and selling slaves. But the person that tweeted it put an American spin on it because the way that Americans know slavery is not the way the Bible had slavery. So here in America, we know slavery is bad. We had a whole civil war about it. But the concept of slavery we had was chattel slavery, where we treated people like animals or inanimate objects, whereas biblical slavery is something completely different. So that's just one of the examples of how we can sometimes take our 21st century understanding of something and apply it to to Scripture. And the reason why often it works within culture is because the culture of our time is something we can all understand. And our culture is not the biblical culture. I saw another tweet, because I live on Twitter, that a lot of people thought that Jonathan and David had very more intimate romantic feelings than previously indicated. Because we live in a culture that oftentimes tends to misinterpret intimate friendships. We live in a culture that doesn't seek to address the sources of people's pain, but to mask it with self-help, follow-your-heart mentalities. And I know that's somewhat political, I'm swinging a little bit heavy, but it can be dangerous to take narratives from stories and apply it to the words of Jesus. So the reason that people often get away with it and convince others of this is because the Bible can oftentimes be very vague and hard to understand. So as a youth minister, I get a lot of biblical questions. I don't get a lot of intellectual biblical questions. But I do get a lot of questions. And one of the first ones that I was ever asked is, how did a bunch of like Middle Eastern dudes from the first century get the whitest names ever? Like John and Mark and Luke. And I had to explain, you know, it was written in Greek, it was written in Hebrew over the span of several thousand years. And since then, it's been transliterated and translated into Greek, into eventually English and Old English. And then kind of this gigantic historical game of telephone is how we got our Bible today. And what we find is not every translation says the same thing. So here in our Sanctuary Pew Bibles, I believe this is the English Standard Version, ESV. Some of us have the NIV. And you'll find that the flow is very different. My personal favorite is NLT because it tends to be pretty straightforward. Now, if you want a good laugh, look up the Hawaiian Pigeon Bible because that thing is hilarious. Because it sounds like a Jamaican man wrote it. But you find that Bibles oftentimes can say different things, and the Bible doesn't come with a handbook on how to interpret it. So when I got my first Bible, there wasn't this giant letter saying, "Dear reader, this is what these words mean. When you encounter this character or this scenario, this is how you should interpret it." Also, you should notice the tone is different because it's written rather than spoken. Something that I am wholeheartedly a stereotypical millennial on is the concept of periods. Like if you send me a text and you add a period at the end or a dot dot dot, I assume that you're mad at me. And that's something that Jim does a lot. Like, he'll be like, "Hey Jim, I got everything ready for Sunday." You want to be like, "Okay, dot, dot, dot." And I'm like, "I have anxiety now. This is Jim." And so we find in the Bible, sometimes it can be that way because it's not spoken, it's written. And so when we read one word, we assume what the tone of a passage is. So we all know that depending on the fluctuation of your voice, it can mean two totally different things. So if you say, "Yeah, totally," or "Yeah, totally," those are two completely different statements, even though you're saying the same thing. And so then it becomes very easy to assume the meaning of a particular passage, and it's even easier to write ourselves into a story that was written 2,000 years before we were ever born. And so the 21st century challenge for us is to use the knowledge and the skills and the sources that we have to interpret the Bible, interpret what it says, first of all, why it says it, who is it saying it to, why it says it, and ultimately, what does that mean for us today? And so there's no greater or hotly debated item than what Jesus says or doesn't say. I know my intro is a little long, but to really understand what Jesus says, we have to understand how Jesus often communicated. And so, this morning we're going to look at a couple of parables. It's kind of a crash course into parables. We don't have time to kind of dig into the deepest parts, but I just kind of want to give a very general introduction into what parables are, how can we interpret parables, because parables are often at the forefront of political or spiritual debate. And living on Twitter, I know how oftentimes those words are misconstrued. So So here's how Jesus often communicated. It was through parables. So when Jesus was on earth, when he was ministering to his followers, he told them stories called parables that illustrate an important point. So Jesus, as the author and the finisher of our faith, knew by telling engaging and interesting stories, he would draw the crowd to him and communicate difficult or perhaps painful truths in a way that they could easily grasp or digest as they went on with their daily lives. So like I said, people often use parables to either suit their agenda or justify certain behavior. They'll say, oh, Jesus said this, or Jesus never said this, as if the Bible exists solely to end discussions instead of starting them. Now remember, the Bible's relational. I talked about in the summer how the Bible is family-oriented. The Bible is also church family-oriented. And so the Bible is always meant to open up a discussion, a conversation, a connection. It's not supposed to close one. But in order to have that honest conversation, we need to have an honest interpretation. So we're going to look this morning at two specific parables that Jesus used, and we're going to talk about what parables are and what they mean for us today. So, first, let's reiterate what a parable is. So the definition of a parable is it's a short, simple story from which a moral lesson can be drawn. I'll say that again. So a parable is a short, simple story from which a moral lesson can be drawn. So a parable, oftentimes, it's a fictitious story. The characters are fake. The situation is fake. But we call them parables and not fables or fairy tales because they illustrate a spiritual lesson in the life of the characters. Oftentimes, with fables or fairy tales, it'll illustrate a physical transformation, whereas parables focus on the spiritual transformation. They're also about real-life people and real-life scenarios. So the scenario here is completely hypothetical, but it's one that could be true to the audience of that time. And so Jesus always knew how to get to the heart of the story, and he knew that his listeners would listen to hear the compelling conclusion to his messages. Stories in general, particularly parables, have this kind of power. Now, in the Gospels, Jesus is recorded to have given at least 42 of these. So he gives 22 in Matthew, he gives 10 in both Mark and Luke. John's written a little bit differently than the other Gospels, and so he's in another category. But ultimately, Jesus uses parables to convey some of the most important truths of who he is, who God is, and how we should live. So what exactly can we learn from a parable? Let's dive in. Our first parable is Luke chapter 5. It's going to be at the tail end. We're going to be looking at verses 33 to 38, so I'll give you a second to join me there. Luke chapter 5. So the first thing I want to communicate today about parables is that parables teach us something about God. So similar to a proverb, the parables of Jesus often have one central meaning. They often continue the trend of having two or more hypothetical characters as well, and upon which the listener or the reader can ultimately decide the role or the end result of the character that they were going to be. So I tell kids at camp this, but what's great about the Gospels is that they never leave us the same. Jesus' parables show us that God has a desire to change us. And so this passage at the end of Luke chapter 5 gives us, it's a very brief but thought-provoking parable, and so I'm going to go ahead and read it in its entirety, and then we will go from there. And they said to him, the disciples of John fast often and offer prayers, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink. And Jesus said to them, can you make wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in those days. He also told them a parable. No one tears a piece from a new garment and puts it on an old garment. If he does, he will tear the new, and the piece from the new will not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst in the skins, skins will be destroyed. But new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. And no one, after drinking old wine, desires new, for he says, the old is good. So this passage in context, to just give you a little bit of background information for the story that we're jumping in, because we're kind of jumping in mid-story with this parable. So it's known as the parable of new wine. And if you look at the section before, it comes after the recruitment of a person named Levi. And it appears to be part of a discussion that Jesus is having at a dinner party that's held by Levi. And so we don't get the full conversation, but we kind of get this little snippet of a conversation that Jesus has. So something interesting about Levi is that Levi is a tax collector. So Jesus is already ticking off the status quo by hanging out with less than reputable characters. So if you were a tax collector in the ancient world, that was one of the sleaziest, most hated jobs that you could have within that culture. And so the Pharisees, who were the religious authority at the time, they see Jesus, they see his disciples hanging out, eating and drinking with them, and they confront him. They ask Jesus some questions, and this passage is given as Jesus' response to those questions. So Jesus says, "Can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them?" And so that's a really weird way to kind of answer their question, but what Jesus is doing is he's answering a question with a connection to the wedding practices of their day. So in ancient Judea, the wedding feast was the most biggest deal of all. That was the piece de resistance. That was the kind of crown jewel of the whole wedding, was the feast. It was the picture of joy and happiness in the culture. Now, being fat, I understand that. I had a nacho bar at my wedding. It was great. And surprisingly, I didn't eat very much of it because I was so scared of getting cheese sauce on my white shirt that, you know, Bethany and I, we didn't eat barely anything at our wedding. We actually stopped by McDonald's all the way home from our wedding. But the wedding feast was supposed to be the kind of top picture of what success and joy looks like. Oftentimes, it was a week long. And so during this feast, it was understood that joy was more important than conformity to religious rituals. Oftentimes, they would not be kosher at these feasts. And so if any ceremonial observance would detract them from the joy of a wedding feast, it was not required. So if kosher was going to detract from the joy you'd have at the feast, then you wouldn't do kosher. You'd kind of disregard that. So Jesus and his followers, because of this, could find themselves in the company of tax collectors and prostitutes and other less than reputable characters without feeling spiritually compromised. However, the gospel never leaves us the same. And so the gospel comes to us as we are, but it doesn't keep us that way. And Jesus was with those tax collectors to convert them. So Jesus continues. He says, "But new wine must be put into new wineskins." When Jesus says this, Jesus is making a very clear point. You can't fit his new life into old forms of living. This explains why Jesus did not begin a reform movement within Judaism. A lot of people thought, especially his disciples, oh, this is somebody that's going to restore Israel. He's going to put things back the way they were. He's going to reinstitute all these laws and make people follow them. But Jesus says, "I haven't come to patch up your old practices. I have come with a whole new set of clothes." So this parable shows us, one, God wants to change us, and two, we can't be saved unless we're changed by God. Jesus reminds us that what's old, what's stagnant, can't be renewed or reformed. Oftentimes, God will look for new vessels to contain his new work. And those vessels eventually make themselves unusable. That's the thing about being a vessel. You think about a vessel. Vessels hold something. And once the vessels no longer hold that something, you discard it. So when I'm done with my Sunny D, I really love Sunny D because I'm diabetic and can't have orange juice here. But when I'm done with the Sunny D bottle, I don't hold on to the Sunny D bottle because there's no longer any more Sunny D, so I toss it. So, this passage reminds us that the religious establishment of any age, not just this age, but of any age, is not necessarily pleasing to Jesus, and sometimes is in direct opposition. The second thing that parables teach us is something about ourselves. So parables teach us something about God. Parables teach us something profound about ourselves. Jesus continues. He says, "And no one, having drunk old wine, immediately desires new, for he says, the old is better." So just because people are more comfortable with the old, some assume that the old is better. Now, the culture we live in, our modern age, is often taken with the new and the shiny rather than what's old. Yet we shouldn't accept or reject something because it's old or new. And I read that passage and I thought about it and I'm like, isn't that how our culture is? Oftentimes we recoil with new ideas because they're accompanied by changes of routine and existential uncertainty. And so this translates to my home life because my wife loves to switch things up, and that terrifies me. I am very much a creature of habit. I have used the same razor blades for 10 years. I have used the same deodorant. I eat the same food. I do the same things. I sit in my same chair and watch my same TV shows. One of the biggest struggles that we often have in our marriage is when Bethany wants to rearrange a room. We had an agreement at the beginning of my marriage that my home office is my sacred space, and that's the only place in the house that she can't touch. I have my office set up in a certain way. I have my knickknacks on a certain shelf. My computer is facing a certain wall. My posters are at a certain angle. That's the way I like it. I like it that certain way. I'm going to like it in 5 years. I'm going to like it when I'm 70. That's the way my office is going to be when I'm 70. That's the way my office is going to be when Jesus comes back. Now my living room is a different story. Oftentimes I will come home and something will be moved, or there will be something new on the wall. Oftentimes we'll rearrange furniture, or add something, or take something out, because she thinks something will make the room look fresh or new or better. And that's because Bethany is not afraid of new ideas, because she knows that new ideas also carry potential to make present situations better. And I love that this is something that Jesus highlights. It's something that Jesus does, not necessarily Bethany, but Jesus, is that Jesus is highlighting humanity's tendencies to cling to the old for the sake of routine. So many of us today are stuck in cycles of sin or abuse or even self-sabotage just because it's what feels familiar. So we become accustomed to those feelings, and anything outside of those feelings are seen as a threat because oftentimes there's uncertainty that comes along with them. Now, on the other half, Jesus is also addressing those who change things for the sake of changing things, because that change may not necessarily be better than what you're getting rid of. Isn't that telling of the people of Jesus' day? Like, consider it. Israel was around for a long time, even before Jesus existed. Well, before he was born, he's always existed. But before Jesus was born on earth, Israel had been around for several thousand years, and they continued the same cycles of kings and war. Now, kings and war are not particularly pleasant things. Kings can boss you around and make weird rules. They can force you to fight. They can force you to pay taxes. And so, Israel, if you look at the list of Israel's kings and the things that they have done, there's only really about five or six of them that were halfway decent. The rest of them were very tyrannical and greedy and warmongering and oftentimes gave Israel a lot of trouble, but they were fine with it. That's why when Jesus comes, they have this mentality that, oh, we've seen this story before. Jesus is going to come down. He's going to be this military conqueror. He's going to restore things, right? Kind of continuing this pattern. And think of the Pharisees, too, that were so stuck on the religious practices of the day. So that's why Jesus says, no one puts a piece from a new garment on a new one. So when Jesus is saying this, he's showing us the reality that patching up an old garment with a piece of a new garment not only disfigures the new garment, but also causes the old garment to become more ragged. Jesus is trying to buck the old system. Because you cannot be reborn and still remain who you were. You have to become something new. The parables not just teach us about God's nature, they also reveal to us truths about human nature. Often that human nature is self-serving and self-preserving. It's a nature that wants its cake and gets to eat it too. We want the blessings of God without the sacrifices. We want the prosperity without work. I think that's something that resonates right now. A lot of people want the pay without the work. You want the fame without the downsides. We want the blessings, the benefits of the new without getting rid of the old. I recently bought a Jeep. It was very expensive. It's very nice. It's my dream car. But I also liked my old car. It was an old Honda. It was really small. It was a 2002, and it was like a four-cylinder, so it sounded like a lawnmower. And it was beat up. The handles didn't work. It had a lot of miles on it. But I loved that car because it got great gas mileage. And there's a lot of good memories attached to that car. Yet when I traded it, what I found is that Jeeps, while they're better, while they're bigger, they also get terrible gas mileage. And I'm like, well, I wanted the newness of the Jeep. I wanted the niceness of the Jeep, the space of the Jeep, but also the fuel economy of a little lawnmower car. And I find that's not the case. You have to pick one or the other. Jesus shows what human nature looks like in this parable. And he also tells us that we cannot be saved unless we put to bed our old way of life to follow him. This leads us to my last point, that parables illustrate our need for something. Parables illustrate our need for something. We're going to look at Matthew chapter 18, so I'll give you a second to flip over there. So we're in Matthew 18. We're going to be specifically looking at verses 23 through 35. So I'll go ahead and read it in its entirety, and then we'll kind of dissect it piece by piece. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him that owed to him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when the same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. And should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant, as I had mercy on you?" But in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. So each parable has its own name. Some parables are more famous than the others. We have the lost sheep. We have the prodigal son. This one's called the parable of the unmerciful servant. And it's one that addresses both the nature of God, the nature of man, but it also illustrates man's need for both redemption and salvation. So we find that the servant in this parable, this hypothetical servant, which is supposed to represent us, owes his master 10,000 talents. So a talent was a type of currency in that time. It was high value. It was like a $100 bill. And it was equivalent to about $12 million. And he owes 10,000 of those. This amount is supposed to be equivalent to an unpayable debt. There's absolutely nothing that this servant can do to fully repay what he owes. And this is supposed to illustrate man's sinful nature and our inability to save ourselves because of sin. We live in a culture that believes we can make our own way, that we can defy reality, that we can make reality what we want. We treat ourselves as miniature gods that can do whatever and save ourselves. But in reality, we're often like children. We're lost. We have no way to take care of ourselves. Because of the fall, we owe a debt to God that we cannot pay because we're not Jesus. He's the only one that has the capability to pay that debt. So, let's move on to the story. We are once again presented with hypothetical characters. Jesus always introduces hypothetical characters that represent people and God. So obviously playing this role as the servant is you and me. We are the role of the servant. God is the master. And other servants are our neighbors. So we find that the master, being merciful, freely forgives this massive debt, this astronomical debt, that the servant has no way of repaying. Now, in his time, in his context, in his day, the servant basically owed his life to this person. The master had every right to have this person thrown in jail. He could have seized their house, their possessions, and according to the custom of that time, he could have even sold them into slavery. Yet the servant says to the master, "Have patience with me and I will pay you." And the promise of the servant doesn't make any sense at all. He speaks as if all he needs was time. That if he was given enough time, he could actually pay the massive debt. And so this is actually Jesus being humorous. This is something that the disciples listening would find funny. He's showing how futile this request is. That if he had all the time in the world, he could never do enough to pay back the debt. Yet the master is merciful and gives the servant something that he doesn't deserve. And the master showed mercy prompted by compassion, forgiving a debt that could never be repaid, despite whatever promises the servant made. So Jesus is conveying to the audience, both the commoner and the Pharisee alike, that Jesus would forgive the sins of the world through his sacrifice, and that he would absorb our unpayable debt and in return offer us mercy, even if we don't deserve it. Even in the moments where we promise God we will do this or that, even though both you and God know that you have no desire or ability to honor your word. So let's push on in the story. So we find that the servant, after being forgiven this huge debt, he goes out and he finds other servants that owe him money. Once again, we are playing the role as a servant. God is the master. The servants are our neighbors. These are the hypothetical characters that represent us in God and everyone around us. And what we find is that the servant, he comes to another servant that owes him 100 denarii, which in Bible times is a much lesser currency. One denarii was the equivalent of 74 cents. So this man who owed almost billions and billions of dollars, this huge, massive debt, calls out somebody that owes him roughly $74. And he demands he pays up. And so what happens to this servant is that he pulls the same card that he used with the master. He says, "Give me time, I can pay you." Now, 100 denarii, unlike the 10,000 talents, was actually something that could be reasonably paid back. It was about 2 months' wages, give or take. And so this is something that can actually be repaid if given a little time, a little mercy. Yet we find that the forgiven servant does not extend forgiveness to the person, but instead has him jailed. My favorite preacher, you all know, because I talk about him all the time, Charles Spurgeon, he comments on this parable in the 1800s. He says, "The debt was very, very small, but the claim was urged with intense ferocity. Our little claims against our neighbors are too apt to be pressed upon them with unsparing severity." So it's crazy that this man owes him $74, and the Bible says he literally grabs him by the throat and chokes him. He is that angry about such a small debt. The other servants see this and tell the master. It's even more sad when you consider there's no mention in this parable about this servant's conscience bothering him. It's only when his fellow servants go to the master that it's really recognized with what is done. And of course, when the master hears this, he's understandably angry. It is wrong for a man who had been given so much to be unforgiving for something so small. And so he ends up giving the first servant what he deserves, justice instead of mercy. And so this parable highlights some very important ideas. The first being that God is more than willing, more than capable to forgive us. But in return, he also expects us to extend that same courtesy to everyone. Remember, Jesus is painting us a scenario where we can choose what the ending will be. We can certainly be like the unmerciful servant. We can choose to have a grudge against people that have wronged us, but it comes with a cost. By not forgiving others for the small things they do against us, we then forfeit the right to be forgiven by God for the big things that we do against him. And instead, the opposite will be true. Instead of getting mercy, instead of getting grace, we'll get what we truly deserve, which is justice. And justice on God's terms is not something you want to be on the receiving end of, ask Sodom and Gomorrah. And so, the principle is clear. The main point of this passage is clear. God has forgiven such a great debt that any debt owed to us is absolutely insignificant in comparison. No person can possibly offend me to the extent that I have offended God. And this principle must be applied in the little things done to us, but also in the big things done to us. That doesn't mean that forgiveness is going to come easy. Remember, Jesus is illustrating human nature. We tend to want benefits for ourselves, but we're stingy and reluctant to do the same for others. I'm a huge history nut. It's something that honestly astonishes me is reading about the year 1865. So 1865 is the year that the Civil War ends, and the country is starting to come back together and healing. And there's still a lot of pain involved because the Civil War was the bloodiest conflict in American history. It's one that put brother against brother, it put community against community. Now, during the Battle of Gettysburg, there were two Maryland regiments that squared off against each other. One of them was Union, one of them was Confederate. They're both from Maryland. And what made this head-to-head conflict even more crazy was the fact that these two regiments were from the same town. Now, both sides of the battle suffered between 60 and 75% casualties. Meaning, out of the 800 men in each regiment, 1,600 in total, 960 of them would be dead and wounded by the end of the day. These were people that knew each other intimately. They shopped at the same stores. They went to the same churches, worked on the same farms. But what amazes me is when you read about what happens after the battle, after the war. So obviously the Union regiment won the engagement. And yet, as the Confederate regiment was retreating, it was the Union troops that were the first to rush out to meet the 68 soldiers, the wounded soldiers, that the Confederate Marylanders had left behind. One of those soldiers had written in his diary that he thought the Union people came to finish them all off. But instead, they came not with rifles, but with food, water, and medical supplies. They took the wounded back to the camp where they coincidentally found that most of them knew each other. And eventually, they all moved back home after the war and forgave each other and reforged their community. Now think about today in comparison where we get mad at someone for very silly things. The other day, my friend got really mad at me because I didn't like his post on Instagram. He's like, I made that post for you, man. You didn't like it. Yet these were men who were literally trying to kill each other. Yet they were able to overlook that and see each other as brothers again. So this is the gospel that the parable is alluding to. It's a very brief story. A lot of these parables are only brief stories. They're little snippets of conversations that Jesus comes from the writer of the story himself, the author of humanity, Jesus. So he told this parable not only to show us how much we need God, but also how much we need each other. It would be wrong to make this into the idea that unforgiveness itself is the unforgivable sin. It's better to say that forgiveness is evidence of truly being forgiven, and that habitual unforgiveness may show that a person's heart has never really been touched by Jesus. What I love about Jesus, whether it's the Last Supper, where he calls out Judas to do what he came to do, what he planned to do, or the woman at the well, where he seemed to know all of her deepest, darkest secrets that she had kept hidden down, or even his parables, is that Jesus understands human nature. Jesus understands people. And that nature is something that has never changed. That's why parables are relevant to us today. The Bible does not need to take our cultural tropes, our cultural patterns that we see in movies and television to make it relevant. Jesus does not need us to forcefully insert our agendas and our 21st century mindsets into his first century story. No, it's instead when we lay these things aside, when we embrace Christ and reject ourselves, do we truly find purpose. Paul in the book of Philippians talks about this at length. He says essentially that the greatest thing a Christian can gain is having our story become part of Jesus' story. And so that leads us to this question: what will you do with Jesus? We come to the concept of acceptance or rejection. You have heard about Jesus, you've heard about what he says, what he understands. Will you accept that as truth? And on top of that, if you accept this truth, how will you respond to that truth? Are you going to keep it to yourself? Are you going to keep Jesus in this little box where you hoard him? Or are you going to share him? In a few weeks, we have a very good opportunity to do that with our Back to Church Sunday, with our youth group cookout. There's going to be many opportunities for us to be Jesus. I'll pray and then I'll invite the worship team back up. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are not just a God that understands the universe and how planets are formed and things like physics, where someone like me, who never took a physics class, of course, can understand. We thank you that you know the universe, that you made the universe, but also we thank you that you know us. And you don't just know us on a surface level, you know us very intimately, to the point where, like a TV show, you can point at someone and know their habits, know what they're going to do, know how they think, know how they function. And Father, we know how hard it is outside of you to fight that human tendency to be selfish and to be self-preserving. And so, Father, we know it's only through you that we can ever hope to change, ever hope to improve, to be better. And so we thank you for your son, Jesus, for making that possible. And we thank you for the mission that you've given us, your church in the grand scheme and the church in the small scheme here in Lane, to spread your word, not that it's ours to give, but that it's something that's going to free and preserve and make the world a better place.